Greetings, friends. Welcome to Head Above Water, a podcast about filmmaking and mental health and wellness and what it takes to find a little bit of peace and happiness in this crazy topsy-turvy business called show. On this episode, lucky number 7, our 7th episode of Head Above Water, we're going to be talking to filmmaker Ken Spooner, an up-and-coming filmmaker from New Jersey who just came out with a movie called Life With Layla, which is seeking distribution now. It's a documentary about Layla, who is the child of heroin addiction, and the film follows her. She's a little 10-year-old girl, and she's very precocious, and I really hope you guys get a chance to see it soon. And during the making of this film, Ken found himself in some many interesting, we'll say, situations as a filmmaker. So we talk a lot about how embedding yourself in a family dealing with pretty hardcore drug addiction, pretty hardcore heroin addiction, the effect that embedding yourself in a family dealing with those kinds of struggles takes on a filmmaker. And we have a really good, interesting talk about that, and I hope you guys really get a chance to see the movie soon. But before we dive into today's interview with Ken, I just want to tell you guys we'll be back next week, next Tuesday, with an all-new episode of Head Above Water. It'll be our Sundance special. We'll be coming at you live from Long Beach, California, right smack dab in the middle of the Sundance Film Festival in Park City, Utah. So I will not be at the festival, but we're going to provide an interview that we did with Ben Wiesner, producer of Beast, which will be playing at the Sundance Film Festival. He was also the producer of Thunder Road, which won the Grand Jury Prize at the 2018 South by Southwest Film Festival, and we'll be showing Beast at this year's Sundance Film Festival. So stay tuned next week for our Sundance special with Ben Wiesner. It's a great conversation. I hope you guys all join us for that. And also, if you would like to support the show, you're welcome to buy me a cup of coffee. Even though the show is a solo production effort, I still have to pay for podcast hosting. I still have to pay for the service that we use to bring our remote interviews to you. So if you're looking to support the show and you like what you've heard so far and you want to hear more, you're welcome to buy me a coffee at buymeacoffee.com/headabovewater. If you check that out, you can support the show there. And we'll also be having some fun behind-the-scenes extras for you coming soon. So I am working on that. So again, if you want to support the show, buy me a coffee at buymeacoffee.com/headabovewater. Stay tuned for our Sundance special next week with Ben Wiesner. But until then, here's our conversation with Ken Spooner. Ken Spooner. Ken, how are you today? Good to talk to you.
I'm doing well, Jason. Thanks for having me on.
Oh, no problem. No problem. It's good to have you on. Now, I still, even though we've known each other for a few months now, is it Ken or Kenny? What do you prefer? I'm sure I've asked you before, but I forget. So what's better to call you?
So my friends actually call me Spoon, you know, because my last name is Spooner.
Okay.
So whatever works for you, man.
So if you were in my office and this was a job interview, would I be calling you Ken or Kenny?
You'd be calling me Ken.
All right. Ken Spooner is with us today. It's good to have you here, Ken. Good to have you here, Spoon. I'm really glad and excited to talk to you because, well, first why don't you give me a little bit of bio and give me a little bit of a rundown about who you are and what you're all about, and then we'll dive into some fun questions.
Cool. Well, I am born and raised in New Jersey. I graduated from Montclair State University in 2013, and I started a small production company called Spoonie Vision Studios.
You're so young. You're so young.
I'm almost 30 years old. It's crazy, man. Time flies. But yeah, after I graduated college, I just started diving into making my own short documentaries. So my first project out of school was called To Be Strong, and it was about a young man who's fighting cancer while trying to be a boxer.
Oh,
it was 14 minutes long, and it actually did really well. It went on to so we got some coverage on some national outlets such as Good Morning America. Oh. It did well, and the success of that short film allowed me to raise some funding to start my new film, Life with Layla, which is about a So Life with Layla is about a family from Sussex County, New Jersey. 5 out of the 7 of the family members are struggling with addiction. And the story is told through the eyes of a 7-year-old girl named Layla.
Wow. Yeah. And we're going to talk a lot about that later because I have a lot of questions for you about that.
Yeah. So, you know,
is this available online?
This is not available online yet. We're trying to find a platform for it, whether that's Netflix or Hulu. So, you know, this is my first time trying to navigate this industry as independent filmmaker. So,
but I mean, is the short available online?
Oh, yes. Yes. So the short is available online. If you go to tobestrongfilm.com. You can view it. It's a 14-minute short.
Awesome. We'll have to put that link into the show notes afterwards. That sounds great.
Oh, thanks, Jason.
Awesome. So let me ask you a little bit about, well, what are you up to now then? Are you just trying to get the word out about Layla?
Yeah. So right now it's just, I'm going to a lot of these networking events and I'm trying to really try, I'm reaching out to news outlets. I don't have a PR firm. I'm a small guy from a small town trying to make a, just trying to make things work. And I know that this film has a lot of potential, and it's just tough navigating the industry for the first time because you don't have the connections that you would when you've been in the industry for 30 years. Right. So,
sure.
So that's what I'm trying to do right now is trying to, you know, I'm just trying to get the right eyes on this, and I'm trying to get the word out there, whether that's via social media or local newspapers, local outlets. We actually just got some great coverage on CBS 2 weeks ago, which was really great for us. And hopefully we can get the ball rolling a little bit more.
That's outstanding. Have you played in any festivals yet?
So we actually premiered at the Montclair Film Festival back in May, and we won the Best New Jersey Film Award, Wow. Which was a great start. But as you know, the festival circuit's kind of tricky, right? So you get into one, you give away your world premiere, and then none of the other big festivals want you.
Sure.
So it's like, it's tough. But I have to say, though, you know, for all the independent filmmakers out there, a film festival is not a testament to your work.
No,
it is absolutely
not.
There's so much things that go into it. There's a lot of politics that go into it. There's a lot of things that, and it does not mean that your work is bad at all.
Of course.
You know, there's a lot of great films out there that do not get selected, and there's so many different ways of going about trying to get your film out there.
Yeah, I mean, festival, like, programmers all have their own agendas. They all have their own sensibilities in terms of what projects speak to them. I've told this story many, many times, and I will tell it many, many times more. We had our world premiere for Getting Over at South by Southwest, but then I only got into two other festivals the rest of the year, and that's out of applying for 40, 50 festivals, you know, even the ones that gave us waivers or some of the international ones that when they heard we premiered in Austin, they were like, yeah, send me your link. Let's check it out. And then you never, ever hear from them again. So getting into or not getting into a festival is definitely no sign, no signal whatsoever as to the quality of one's work. And it's very tough to separate the two.
Absolutely. I totally agree with that.
Well, let's talk about Life with Layla a little bit. Tell me about the origin of this idea. When did you decide that you wanted to make a film? And this is really why I wanted to speak to you and why I was very excited to speak to you, because my film is about addiction. It's about my father's drug addiction, his heroin addiction. Where did you get the original idea to want to do a film about addiction?
So actually, I lost a good friend to an overdose back in 2014, I really wanted to make a difference, and I wanted to really show what was going on. So I talked to my co-director and co-producer, Mike Mee. You know, Mike has been such a great partner so far, and you know, we've done a lot of work together since we graduated college. And actually, we made our first film while we were in college. We studied abroad. We went to Amman, Jordan together, and we shot our first documentary about a nonprofit in the Middle East, which was an eye-opening experience because that was the first time he ever went abroad. And it was the second time that I went abroad, but being in the Middle East, it's a whole different world. It's
sure.
Really unbelievable. So Mike and I go way back and we work so well together. He's my yin to my yang, I guess you can say. He sees things that I don't see and vice versa. And as an independent filmmaker, you can't make a film alone. It's impossible. And if you do, I mean, it's going to be shit. I'm sorry.
More power to you if you can.
You just can't do it alone.
It
you need
takes
a great
a village.
Team. You know, so Mike and I are really, we work so well together. And, you know, when it was time to make Life with Layla, he actually did a lot of the work trying to raise the funds and reaching out to people, scheduling the interviews. He actually has some family members too that have struggled with addiction. So We really wanted to do something that was rooted in New Jersey because we're both New Jersey guys.
Right.
And we both have a personal connection with the topic. So that's why we really wanted to go ahead and try to tell a story that really mattered, but we had to do it differently. There's been addiction films time and time and again that have been covered. They've been hit. HBO has done it. Netflix has done it. What was going to make our film different?
Right.
At the time in 2015, we didn't know what we were going to do. We just wanted to tell a broad story, a macro story about what was happening in our state. So we went ahead. We interviewed a former governor of New Jersey. We interviewed a lot of addiction experts.
Which governor did you interview?
We interviewed Governor McGreevy.
Okay.
He was the New Jersey governor. I don't want to give you a year, but I want to say...
a few years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, being from New York, I'm not intimately aware of New Jersey politics, but you always hear, you know, like Christie Tyler.
Yeah, of course. And, you know, Governor McGreevy was great, and he's really passionate about what is going on in the state, and he actually gave us one of our best interviews. But I don't know if I ever told you this, but you know, once we found the Boris family, which is the family that we covered over the course of 4 years, we actually cut out our first family that we found and all of the addiction experts. So we essentially spent $20,000 shooting our first, like all of our first interviews and all that stuff. And once we found this family, we cut it all.
Wow.
And
that's not to say it's wasted money per se at all.
Oh, no, it's not.
It informs the work and gives you at least, you know, a personal foundation on, you know, how to interview people, how to, you know, get your feet wet with this kind of filmmaking, this kind of, you know, intense, intimate filmmaking. So, you know, it's all steps in the process.
Of course. And so the other producer on the film is Steve McCarthy, and he has 30 plus years in the business. He actually just finished the film on HBO. It's called Breslin and Hamill Deadline Artists. You can find it on HBO Go. So, Steve was a co-director on that, and he's done a lot of work for 60 Minutes and Dateline, and he is a veteran producer.
That's
so
great.
When you have a guy like that, and he's working with us who, like, we're just trying to navigate and make our first feature, it's really, really helpful in the process.
How did you find him? How did you bring him on board?
He was actually my professor in college.
Oh.
Yeah. So I've been working with Steve for a long time, and he's been my mentor, and he's taught me everything that he knows about the business. And there's always more things for me to learn. And Steve has been great. So when I was in college, Steve actually treated me like I was working for him full time. I was not a student to him. I was his PA. He told me what to do. Like, and that was it. And that's how the business is. You know, people are not going to be nice to you. And it helps if you aren't like, I met a lot of great people in this industry, but it is a cutthroat industry. You're not going to work with people all the time that you like or, you know, that you dislike as well. So
it's a professional environment and you got to act like a professional.
Exactly. But yeah, Steve treated me like a professional when I was in college. And I think that helped me tremendously as I moved into the professional world.
That's great.
So yeah, so Steve was a big help. And once we had him on board, he guided us and he really taught us how to, you know, he was the guy that helped us mold the story into what it is right now.
Yeah. And you definitely need someone like that. My editor, Sharon Rutter, she was the one that served that purpose for me, who, you know, helped take all of this personal, intimate footage and figure out where the story is there.
Exactly.
You know, there's a story in there somewhere, but yeah, you always need a little bit of help to craft that and figure out how to get down to the real nitty gritty of what you're trying to say.
And also it helps to have a third eye on 100 hours of footage.
Of course.
All this footage, and you know, you're trying to cram it down to less than 90 minutes. Our runtime right now is about 68 minutes.
Okay. Well, that's still pretty juicy.
It is
juicy.
Tight. It's tight.
When you were in the middle of interviewing other people and you decided you were going to look for families, like what was talk to me about the process of not just finding the Boris family that, you know, became the focus of the film, but just meeting other families that have been touched by addiction. And how did you handle interacting, you know, before you guys even shot with anybody,
mm-hmm.
or before you guys even got to decide on the primary subjects? You know, talk to me about dealing with families in crisis. And how you have to walk such a fine line to, you know, not, you can't just barge in there with a camera and be like, we're filming you now.
Yeah.
So talk to me about your process on how you decided to approach these families and deal with them on such an intimate level on something that's really personal.
So when we first started, we did talk to a few different families, and the approach, you know, it's all of these people have had something happen in their lives that is so dramatic and so heartbreaking. And honestly, you just have to go in there and listen to them. It's not your turn to talk. It's your turn to listen. And I think that is when you're making a documentary film, I think that if you do listen and you do listen to your subjects and you listen to the people that you're talking to, that's how you're going to find the story. You know, you have to be very cognizant of what they are going through. This is not about the film. It's about them. And so we actually found a family before before the Boris family. They're the Morella family. And Maureen Morella, her son, his name is Jesse Morella. And he actually overdosed on heroin when he was in high school. It was his first time doing it.
Wow.
He was, I don't want to get the wrong term, but I want to say he was a paraplegic. He has use of his arms and legs, and his mind is still there.
Mm-hmm.
He's just, I don't really know yet the technical term for it, but heroin ruined his life.
On the first time he ever did it.
When he ingested the heroin, he went home and his mom essentially found him choking on his own vomit. And that caused, you know, the oxygen, it did not, it was not able to go to his brain. From there, he went to the hospital and the doctor said that, you know, he was going to be in that state for the rest of his life. So we actually spent a year interviewing the Morella family, following Jesse, and their story is incredible. And I really wish, and I still have all the footage, so you never know.
I was like, you might have a follow-up right there.
And their story is incredible. And they actually go to schools to talk about what happened to Jesse. So their goal is to reach high school students as well. And I feel terrible. I never want to cut story, but just... It was just a thing with the Boris family. We just had to, it was either all or nothing with them. But right. That doesn't mean that we can't do anything with the Morella family.
How long had you, did you shoot with that family?
We shot with them for, I want to say, about 6 months to a year.
Okay, so you spent a significant amount of time with them.
Yes, and for the first year of shooting the Boris family, I want to say we kind of overlapped. We were following two families at once because... We didn't know which one that we were going to do, if we were going to make a film that had both families involved or if it was just going to be one family. So we wanted to keep our options open there. You know, but when it came time to put a rough cut together, we came to the conclusion that this film was about one family. It couldn't be about two because there was so much that was going on.
Yeah.
Steve, he gave us some great advice and he said, you know, sometimes the best stuff that you produce is the stuff that you don't produce at all. And we had to cut the Morella family, which, you know, it still kind of hurts, but,
I mean, yeah, like I said, you know, you sounds like you have a lot of footage. You can always do a follow-up. You can always do like, you know, a short that's a, you know, a companion piece. You know, there's any number of things you can do to still pay that family the respect that they deserve. Not that cutting them out is, you know, being disrespectful.
Of course.
You know, it's the process of making the film. But let me ask you this. How did you put the vibe out? How did you reach out and get these families? Did you put an ad in the paper? How did you find these families first? You know, because one thing, you know, because it's very interesting to me. Again, like my film is my family story. So like I had it right in front of me. But it always amazes me. I think people want to tell their story, you know, so even though it's something that's so heartbreaking and so emotional and so intense for the people experiencing it, I find that people still want to share their story. So I've always been very interested as to how people find their subjects.
You know, so when we first started filming, we didn't really know anybody. So I put a post out on Facebook and then Mike reached out to get some mutual friends. And fortunately, those mutual friends got back to us with some families that might be interested. And then we did some pre-interviewing with our first family and some other families as well. It was just a mix between Facebook and, you know, and just, you know, some mutual friends. There wasn't anything elaborate that we did. We just put, you know, we just put some feelers out there and we did some follow-up interviews. And then we decided to stick with a couple stories. You know, why we decided to stick with the Boris family, and we didn't know this until about 2 years into filming them, was this little girl, Layla, really popped out to us when we first sat her down in front of the camera. And the story is really told through her eyes. That's what separates this documentary about addiction from other documentaries about addiction. So that's the main reason why we decided to stick with the Boris family, to tell their story. But as far as finding the families, yeah, it was just a mix of some mutual friends and just ads on Facebook.
Wow. So it must be quite a prevalent, I mean, it's a prevalent problem across the country, but in New Jersey, especially, it must be if you didn't have to go far, unfortunately, to find someone who's been touched by this.
Listen, I mean, I'm not sure what it's like out west, but here you cannot go out of your town without finding somebody who has a personal connection to what is going on. It is so prevalent. People are dying every single day. And we started shooting in 2015, and it was really bad back then. And we thought it would, you know, stop by now. It's not. It's insane.
Wow. Well, let's talk a little bit about the Boris family then, and about the process of shooting with them. So you said you shot with them for two years before. Is that 2 years before Layla was introduced to you, or 2 years before you realized, hey, let's focus the film on her experiences?
So we actually started shooting the Boris family, I want to say August of 2015, and we didn't do any pre-production for this. We just went into filming. We actually interviewed Greg Boris in his hotel room in Elizabeth, New Jersey, right after he just got done shooting Dope. So that was really raw for us. And that was our first introduction into that world.
So you interviewed him, or you shot him, met him while he was high?
While he was high. And the first time that the viewer meets him in the film is the first time that we met him.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Like there was no pre-interview. There was no like phone conversation. It was just come over and you can shoot me. And here I am and I'm high on drugs.
Yeah. So at that point, Greg was on the run from the law. So Kate, who is Layla's mom, had the only contact for him. So we had to go through Kate to organize that interview because we weren't able to get in touch with Greg. So essentially we showed up, we went into the hotel room, we threw up the lights, and you know, we really started shooting that day. And Greg, he opened up to us about what was going on, what happened to his sister. She overdosed about 3 weeks before we started filming. So everything was really raw, and it all happened in a short period of time. And then we kept rolling with it. And then, so the film was essentially about Greg losing his sister. And then 2 years into filming and following that story, we sat down, Layla at, I want to say, 6.5, 7 years old, and we found out that she knew what was going on. And for a 7 year old to have that type of knowledge and that wit, and she's funny and she was wise, and we were like,
definitely wise beyond her years. She's very precocious.
She's very, very precocious. And I said to Mike, I'm like, listen, Mike, I think we have our story here. And it was hard to see at that time, but once we started sitting Layla down more and we started talking to her, so we interviewed her at 7 years old, 8 years old, and 9 years old. So the story started to take shape through her perspective about what was going on with her family. So it's not a film about Layla, it's a film about her family, but it's told through her eyes.
Right.
And I think that's a perspective that hasn't been seen yet.
That's great. This was the genesis of my film and my ideas. Like, you never see the effect on their children or their family. And we never humanize these people. We just call them junkies. We just see what they're doing. And we just, then when we're done and we use them for their story, we push them off to the side and they're forgotten until the next story comes out. You know, so it was very important to me to let people know that these people are human. They experience life just like sober people do. There's tragedy, there's success, there's joy, there's sorrow. And these are real people that deserve a little bit more respect than I think they're usually given, you know, unfortunately, in the media at large.
It was so important for us to humanize this family and to show that they are great people. So just because they have an addiction problem or there's, you know, there are other things that are going on, that does not mean that they are bad people. They are just like you and me. And our goal with this film was to show that there is a chance for recovery. And we want to show that there is hope.
Absolutely.
That was our goal, is to help people, you know? So hopefully we're spreading that message, but
it's hard. It's hard.
It's hard, yeah.
So let me take you back to that first time you shot with Greg. You said his name was Greg, right?
Yeah.
Had you ever seen someone under the influence of heroin before? Was that the first time you experienced that?
That was the first time I experienced it.
Tell me a little bit about not only your interaction with him while he was high, but after you guys wrapped, like, tell me how did that moment affect you?
That's actually the first time someone's ever asked me that. So props to you for asking great questions, Jason. Well,
that's the point. That's the whole point of this show, is because we can talk about the projects and they're important and we will, but that's going to leave an imprint on you. Maybe I've seen my father high. I honestly, if I did, it was when I was a child and certainly don't remember, but I generally don't see people who are under the influence of heroin and how that, you know, affects a person. So I'm really, really interested in how it affected you. So yeah, tell me a little bit about, you know, both talking to him, interacting with him at the time, and after you wrapped on the way home, like, what imprint did that leave on you?
So as I said before, we kind of went into his hotel room. Greg was in the bathroom with his friend shooting up, and he was in there for a half hour. So we were able to set up the lights.
So you guys were just in the hotel room setting up for a shoot while someone was in the bathroom with his buddy getting high on heroin.
Yeah.
That's intense, man. That is.
And at this point, you know, setting up the lights and everything and, you know, getting the camera set, trying to figure out how we wanted to shoot it. We didn't know how he was going to react to the cameras. You know, when you're high, your mind is not right.
Right.
And there was a lot of, you know, what if this happens and what if that happens?
What if he gets violent? What if the lights freak him out? I mean, any number of things.
There are so many factors into what could have went wrong. So with that shoot, we decided to bring Steve McCarthy along because he has done stories about addiction before. He's been in scenarios like this and we needed his experience. So having him there was really helpful. So once we got the camera set, Greg comes out of the bathroom and he introduces himself. Hi, my name is Greg. What is your name? And he sits down.
So he was polite.
He was a nice guy. Yeah. I mean, you know, right off the bat. And also Greg is a nice guy in general.
That, you know, that usually helps.
Yeah. And, you know, just Greg at that point in Greg's life, he was going through such a rough time and Greg is just a phenomenal human being. He just was going through something that no human should go through at that point in his life. So at that point, Greg was at rock bottom 3 weeks prior.
And he had just lost his sister 3 weeks earlier.
3 weeks before to a heroin overdose, and he found her in the hotel room.
He was, wow.
So imagine, you know, being in this state of mind.
That's a lot of shit.
It's a lot of shit to process. And it's a lot of shit to process for myself.
So tell me more about, so you interacted with him. He seemed to be polite and nice and he was well-spoken. Like, yeah, but I mean, that still has to leave an imprint on you.
Absolutely. Yes. You know, so we sit him down. So we have him sign a release. And also, you know, we had him sign a release like 3 years later as well,
right,
when he was sober and in the right mind, you want to get him signed again.
Of course.
And then, you know, he signed the release and it was me, Steve, and Mike in the hotel room, and then Greg, and then his sister, Kate, his twin sister, Kate, and his friend, Steve, who was there shooting up in the room with him. And he lights up a cigarette. We do his little sound test and we get him mic'd up and we just start asking him, you know, just questions, just really like easy questions about who he is, where is he from.
Get him to open up a little bit.
And Mike, and you know, Mike did a great job at that. Mike is a fantastic interviewer. And, you know, as the interview went on, he started to open up about his past life. And Mike, you know, the last question that we asked him was, what was your relationship like with your sister, Melissa? She was the one that overdosed. And Greg, he broke down. And he starts to cry. And this was the first time in the interview where he actually showed emotion. And to see that unfold in front of your eyes on camera, you feel what this kid is going through at that
point. Yeah.
It just shows in his eyes and in his face and in his body language. I mean, it's tough for me to explain, but that, you know, that little scene is in the film and, you know, you will see that. And after the interview, Mike and I and Steve drove home and we were just like, I mean, that was my first time experiencing something like that, talking to a person who was under the influence and interviewing them about the most intimate moments in their life and their family history. And, you know, we were just questioning, like, is this kid going to make it? You know, that's one of the first questions we asked ourselves is, I really hope this kid is okay, because no one is looking after him really. He has some contact with his sister and I'm not sure how much of contact he was in with his family, but you don't know if he's going to be okay.
And you don't mean like okay, like in, you mean like in that very moment, like he could be gone the next day. That's a lot of weight, you know, for a filmmaker to carry. He's already high while you're talking to him, and now you're getting him to open up about some of the most intimate private details of him and his family's life. You have to be wondering, like, is he gonna just use that to go over the deep end? I mean, luckily he didn't, but you have to be wondering that at the time.
Yeah, no, absolutely, you know, absolutely. It's and it was scary for me the first, you know, just thinking about that after the first hour of meeting this kid. And I can't imagine being in his sister's shoes or his mom's shoes or his dad's shoes, wondering, okay, my son is in a hotel room in Elizabeth, New Jersey, and he is doing heroin. I don't know where he is. I don't know what he's doing. As a family member, I can't even imagine your thought process every day of, you know, what is going to happen to my brother? What is going to happen to my son? And so many families are out there right now in America who are going through that exact same thing.
Of course.
No family should have to go through that.
No, certainly not. Certainly not.
That scene really sets sets the tone for the rest of the film.
After that initial shoot and you guys are driving home, did you have any doubts? Did you say to yourself or say to Mike or Steve, like, maybe we shouldn't be doing this. Maybe this is a little bit too intense. Maybe I'm not quite ready for all that this is going to entail. I mean, you ended up doing it for another 3-4 years, you know, but at the time, did you have any immediate doubts that said, maybe this is not for me?
No. So we didn't have any doubts. We thought that Greg's story was worth telling and that Kate's story was worth telling. And we wanted to follow this story as it unfolded. There were no doubts about, you know, about being too much or if it was too intense for us. We're filmmakers, we're storytellers. And, you know, when you're making a documentary, you have to stay objective as possible. And you have to not really attach yourself to the emotions and what is going on. So we decided to keep rolling with that. You know, following Greg's story, we saw the absolute worst in him, and then we saw the absolute best in him. And it was just, I mean, the two people are just, I mean, it is so opposite. The Greg that we saw in the hotel room, and then the Greg we saw in Florida. So when we sat him down when he was four days in like a detox program, two different people, and we got to see the real Greg. And people need to see that, the real person behind the dope and what is going on.
Absolutely. Yeah. Cause I mean, the drugs, I said, if you're not a violent person, drugs don't usually, I mean, depending on how bad you do them and how bad they are, I find that they generally don't change your core being. You know, my father was not a violent person. He wasn't a generally angry person. And when he would rob people to get money to buy drugs, he never actually used a weapon. He would reach for his pocket and say, I have a knife, don't make me use it. Mm-hmm. But he wasn't a violent person. He never actually had a knife, you know, because it wasn't in his nature, even sober. It wasn't in his nature to be that kind of person.
No, for sure. And it was important for us to show that.
So how many times did you interview, and then I want to talk about Layla a little bit, but how many times did you interview Greg over the course of the project?
So we interviewed Greg once in August of 2015 when he was at his lowest point in his addiction. And then we kept following his story, you know, through his family. So we sat down Kate, we sat down Greg's dad, we sat down a couple other family members. And then the next time we interviewed Greg was in Florida when he was in detox or 4 days removed from detox. And that was the first time that, you know, the Mike and I saw him sober. And then we interviewed him a third time once he graduated from the drug court program in Sussex County in October of 2017. So we interviewed him about 3 or 4 times throughout the process, but only 2 of those interviews made the cut.
Got it. Got it.
Once in the hotel room and then once in Florida.
Great. Let's talk about Layla a little bit then. Tell me about the first time you interviewed her. Guys, when you see this movie, like you'll see it for yourself. But when you first met her and sat down with her and talked to her, like how aware was she of her family's situation and how readily was she to talk about that?
So the first time sitting down with Layla, she was about 6.5 years old. She didn't have any teeth. She was this cute little girl who wanted to be a movie star, and she loved the camera. So we sat her down and we asked her really simple questions like, what is your favorite color? What is your favorite food? What is your, you know, what do you like to do with your mom for fun? And it was important for us to make her familiar with us and also the camera. So the first interview really wasn't about her family, but we did ask her, what does your mom tell you about drugs? Mm. And she says that they're bad for you. That first interview with Layla, unfortunately, did not make the cut, but we kept interviewing her throughout the process. And as she gets older, we start to ask her tougher questions, like what is addiction? What is Suboxone? Which is, and you know, for those of you who don't know what Suboxone is, it helps you get off heroin.
Right.
And Layla, she knows what's going on, and you can see that through interviews. And there's one interview that we shot where she's sitting there with her friend, and Layla is basically teaching her about drugs and their heroin epidemic. And her friend just sits there and says nothing, which is actually really special. You're going to have to see it. But yeah, so Layla, I mean, just over the course, and then, you know, when she's 8 or 9 years old, she really starts to open up to the camera. And then she talks about her family members going to jail. And she opens up about how drugs affected her and how her family, at the end of the film,
no spoilers,
but, you know, things start to look up. And Layla tells us that there is hope.
That's great.
That's so important, especially coming from a 7-year-old girl.
I mean, yeah, to be that pure and genuine in your emotion and to be that, you know, yet to and yet be so cognizant of what's happening around you, but to still not be so jaded by it that you give up that hope. That's the kind of innocence you can only get from a little girl.
I couldn't even imagine being 7 or 8 years old talking about this kind of stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't.
Yeah, like, and it just shows how addiction not only affects the user, but it affects the family, and it trickles down to children.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so Layla's mom is sober. She's a great mom, and she does everything she possibly can for her kids, especially Layla. Just now that filming is over, Kate and I are great friends. Layla's my extended family. You know, she's so smart, and I'm so excited for her future. I mean, who knows where she's going to be when she graduates high school or college.
Maybe she'll be a filmmaker.
Maybe she'll be a filmmaker. She does want to travel. So when I was out west in California, Layla was very, very jealous because that's where she wants to go. She wants to go out to California to meet Ellen DeGeneres.
You said earlier that you, even after you interviewed Greg that first time, that you didn't have any doubts about whether or not this was, you know, the right project for you, a project that you wanted to continue to pursue. At any point during the production, did anything happen that, not necessarily to bring doubt into your mind, but did anything happen where you were like, because you said, you wanted to be a little more journalistic about it. You wanted to take a step back and let the events fold in front of you and not influence them in any way. Did anything ever happen where you kind of had to hold yourself back and be like, I need to get involved right now. This family, something is happening. You know, maybe Greg was using or what, something happened that you were like, I need to personally intervene to try to, you know, save something. Did that ever happen at any point? And if it did, how did you deal with not doing that?
So it happened once when we were driving Greg to detox. He was shooting up in the back seat and his sister was in the front seat and Kate couldn't see what was going on. So I felt an obligation to tell Kate that Greg was shooting up in the back seat.
Oh, well, so like even when they were in the same car, she was trying to sneak it.
Exactly. Yeah. And I just felt, you know, you just can't let someone do that, especially behind Greg's sister's back. And, you know, that's something that I would never want to do in the first place, you know? So I had to let Kate know that he was, you know, that he was doing that.
Were you driving? Were you in the back seat?
I was in the back seat with Greg. Yeah.
Wow. And was that the first time that you had seen him do the drugs? Cause that first time you said he was in the bathroom doing it. Is that the first time you saw someone?
No, like, that's actually the second time. So actually I followed Greg for a night when he was in the hotel room. This was about a week after his initial interview and he shot up once then. So essentially it was my second time seeing him shoot dope.
So you're in the back seat and you're telling his sister in the front seat, in the front passenger seat, hey, he's shooting up right now.
Yeah.
Tell me about that. Did he get angry at you? You're sitting right next to him. Like we said, he's not a violent person, but like he's got a needle.
and see, like I took that into consideration. I actually sent a text message to Kate.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Because like I didn't know how he would react if I would just blatantly tell Kate out loud.
Yeah, you must have been very scared.
I mean, I wasn't scared. I was just a little bit concerned because
I'm scared for you right now just hearing it.
I didn't know what state of mind he was in at the time. And, you know, when an addict goes to detox, if they don't want to get clean,
right,
they're going to shoot dope. It's their final time. And so that scene, it actually made the film. And you see him do a triple threat. He shoots his needle, he takes a shot of Fireball, and then he smokes a cigarette. And he, you know, after that point, he was ready to go to detox. He got his last fix. And unfortunately, when we got the detox, there was no beds for him. So that day, he wasn't able to get help. So just imagine, like, you want to go get help.
And they turn you away.
And they shoo you away.
Wow.
I just, like, can't even imagine, you know, there's... Unfortunately, there's, you know, there's not a lot of outlets as far as beds go. People aren't able to get help when they want it. And I think that's a problem that our state has to figure out, or I think the rest of America has to figure out.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's a lot of other factors. You know, you just can't snap your fingers and say, oh, you know, there's a bed for you. Everything's going to be good. You know, there's a lot of things that we have that we as a country have to work on when it comes to getting these people the help that they need.
Absolutely. I can't say I have a solution for it. You know, my solution was to just try to get my father's story out to the world, just like you with Layla. Like, you just want to get their story out and bring that awareness. You know, we're all aware of the problem, but we shut it out. We put up walls. We pretend these people are lesser than, and it's someone else's problem. And we go on about our day. And I wanted to do something that said, my father was a person. He was a real human being, and he deserves to be remembered. And that's how I'm going to contribute. So the only way I know how to help in some small way is to tell my father's story, get this out to the world in the only way I know how, and that's by making a movie.
Exactly. And you know, film is a powerful medium, and you can make a lot of difference with it. You know, it's just about finding your audience and getting the right eyes on it and just pushing it. And if people watch your film, if people watch my film, they're going to leave that theater and they're not going to talk. They're going to think about what they just watched.
We hope.
You would hope that. And, you know, that's my goal, is for people to think about what they watched and how that they can change, you know, maybe not themselves, but if they have someone struggling with addiction, maybe they can think about how that they could, how they can help that person,
you know, in their own way. Maybe it's not making a movie, it's not legislation, but how they themselves can make a difference in even just one other person's life can go a really long way.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
After having worked on this project for 4 or 5 years now, how do you feel changed as a person by being introduced to this family, by being in such intimate yet intense environments? Like, how do you feel, not just as a filmmaker, but as a person, how do you feel changed by this entire experience?
Another great question, Jason. So I feel that this film and the making of this film made me a better listener and a better person, because I'm more open to, you know, like, this filmmaking process. Like, it's not about me, it's about the story. And I've never had to sit back and think how this made me a better person.
Because this stuff doesn't happen in a vacuum. You know, it's going to influence your future work. I made a movie about my dad, but he was already gone for 20 years. I've never sat next to anyone in the backseat of a car while they stuck a needle in their arm, man. That's gonna leave an impression.
Your film is incredible. Watching those tapes years after they happened must have been,
it's crazy. But again, like, there was always, and people always ask me that, like, how can you make such an intense film about your family like that? I'm like, but there was always a separation. Like, my father wasn't in front of me. He was always on the screen.
Yeah.
Like, so there was always a distance there, and that made approaching it easier. But you're trying to adhere to some journalistic practices. You're trying to, you know, be a right and proper and professional filmmaker, but you are experiencing this just as much as they are.
Of course. And, you know, like, this, you know, this whole process, it made me a better filmmaker. It made me a better storyteller. I was the editor on it. It made me a better editor, even though I hate editing.
Well, I'll hook you up next time. I'll give you the friends and family rating.
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly. You know, and it just made me a better shooter. And, like, now I have the confidence that after finishing my first feature length film, you know, shooting it and editing it, I can do anything. You know, if I just have to really, you know, if I could put my head to the grind and really figure out how to, I can find a way to make a film. And this whole process really, you know, just justifies that. Throughout the whole filmmaking process, you have so many doubts. Am I doing the right thing? Am I telling the right story? Is this too long? Is this too short? Does this film, does this scene work? Does it not work? There's so many questions and doubts that you have. And just being able to finish this is an accomplishment for not only myself, but for my team, and most importantly, the family. They're the ones that gave everything and trusted us. And without the family, we would have absolutely nothing.
Right. And you want to respect that.
And it took 4 years to make, because it had to be done the right way. Like, this is people's lives you're messing with.
Yeah, yeah. You can't rush through something like that. They're on their own time.
Exactly. And it was just so important to me that we told their story the right way, and not only right, just like accurate. We couldn't get anything wrong. The facts had to be right. it just made me more cognizant of what other people are going through and how much of an impact a film can have on not only a family that you're covering, but also the audience that watches it.
Outstanding, man. That is the right answer. That's the correct answer, 100%. And I'm excited to hear, I'm excited to see your future work. I'm excited to see you develop as a filmmaker. I'm always here to help you in any way I can.
Listen, man, like I would love to work with you one day.
I'm sure we will.
Whether that's a short film or feature, whatever, I can see us working together.
Absolutely. And I appreciate that. And it'll be a really great time.
Yeah.
So do you have any other projects that are on, not that I'm fishing for work, but do you have any other projects that are on the horizon? What are you up to right now?
So right now I'm actually writing a narrative film.
Okay, great.
It's about student loan debt.
Okay. That's also a very timely subject.
You know, being a filmmaker, you just don't have to do one type of genre.
Right.
I want to expand my work as a filmmaker, and I want to be able to tell stories from all points of view. My first film was about cancer. My second film was about heroin addiction. And I always told myself if I finished the one about heroin, I would do one that makes people laugh.
Great. Because we need that. It can't just be all about all the heavy stuff. You know, life is also about the happy, joy, fun times.
Exactly. And there are some scenes in Life with Layla that will make you laugh. It's not all sad. Layla brings out the humor. And I mean, she really makes you ride the roller coaster.
That's great. I'm looking forward to seeing it. I'm looking forward to it being out there. You'll have to keep us in the know. Gang, we'll let you guys know when Life with Layla is available. Ken, where can we find you online if we want to follow your future projects or learn more about Life with Layla as it's about to be released and all that? Where can we find you?
So my company website is spoonievision.com, and my Instagram is just my name. It's Kenny Spooner. And we are get the movie website up. It's lifewithlaylamovie.com, so that should be up this week.
Yep, we'll link to that for sure.
And yeah, that's... That's it.
Is there a trailer for the film that's online or will be online so that people can at least get a little taste before it's out?
There isn't a trailer yet. I've been told that if I do get, you know, distribution for this project, that they're going to do the trailer.
You should still do your own trailer. I did my trailer, and then when I finally sold it, they just took it. Well, Ken Spooner, it was a real pleasure talking to you. I was, again, like having made a movie about my own family, I've been extremely interested to hear more about another filmmaker working on an addiction documentary, a personal addiction documentary that wasn't necessarily about them, and that experience of working with subjects who you don't know, at least initially, and who aren't family, because it's a totally different experience, and I really appreciate you sharing that experience with me, and I hope it's educational for everyone else listening. Again, find Kenny online. He's on Instagram, Kenny Spooner, spoonievision.com. And Ken, thanks again, and we will talk to you soon for sure.
Thank you so much, Jason. It was a pleasure.
Absolutely. I'll talk to you soon.
You got it.
All right. Take care.
Bye.
And that's our conversation with Ken Spooner. Thank you for joining us, Ken. It was really good talking to you. Hope you guys all enjoyed our conversation. It's a bit of a different tack on the mental health and wellness that I usually speak about on the show, but very important nonetheless to talk about because a documentary filmmaker embedding themselves into a situation that's not necessarily their own can be very stressful as well. So thank you guys for joining us for that conversation. Again, don't forget next week our Sundance special with Ben Wiesner, producer of Beast Beast, premiering at this year's Sundance Film Festival. So stick around for more interviews with some of today's young finest independent filmmakers, and we'll see you guys on the next episode of Head Above Water. Take care. Bye-bye.